This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. O Lord, save us. O Lord, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And so welcome to the house of the Lord on this beautiful autumn morning. It's good to be here with you. And I'd like to ask those who have announcements to start to line up here to make them. The only thing I want to mention in terms of announcements is we normally have Bible study on the first Tuesday of the month, and this week coming up, I think there's a conflict, so Bible study won't be this Tuesday, it will be a week from Tuesday. Then in November, we'll be on the first Tuesday. So it's October the 11th is our first Bible study, and we'll pick up where we have been in Acts of the Apostles, and we'll visit Ephesus as well as read the scripture that goes along with that. So are there other announcements that need to be made?
The youth yard sale yesterday was a huge success. And first of all, I want to tell everyone thank you for all your donations, all your help, pricing the stuff, to helping cook, to helping put the stuff up. We made, and I don't know an exact amount yet until Jerry gets back with me with counting all the change and everything, but it's going to be over $1,700 that we made yesterday. Awesome. So huge success. A lot of work, but we had a lot of good times doing it. Next week, of course, is the bazaar. And the kids, are going to be instructed today. Please show up and help at the bazaar. Also, today is the crop walk that the kids are participating in. So right after lunch, we'll be meeting here at 1:15, 1:30. Sign off on some releases that, of course, the church is requiring the parents to sign off on. And then we will go and turn in what we have collected for the crop walk over at the Ursinus Church, Rockwell Methodist. Okay, well, you know where we're going, so I'm good with that. But we will go and walk. It will start at 2. I have not heard how far the walk is, whether it's 1 mile, 3 mile, 5 miles. I don't know. So we're going to walk, and then we will let the parents know when we're on our way back to the church. We'll just let the parents pick the kids back up at our church. Also, the kids are selling tickets for the Hee Haw Show and dinner. It is $10 a person. So please see one of the youth for a ticket, but they do have the tickets. I think you got everybody tickets this morning.
Yeah.
But everybody that was here does have tickets on them, okay? All right, thank you.
First, I want to thank everybody that helped with the noodle making. The long list is in your insert in the bulletin. We had a great turnout. We had fun and worked hard. We did 230 pounds of noodles, and there are some ribbles that were left over. So the table's full and ready for the bazaar. We would ask this week that if you have things to bring to the bazaar, like canned goods or crafts, if you could get them here as soon during the week as you can, it helps us so much with setup and pricing. So thanks so much, and it's going to be a great bazaar.
There's a religious sect called the Quakers. There's a religious sect called the Shakers. I think we're the movers and shakers. When you listen to what all's going on here, it's just almost mind-blowing, you know, what all really goes on. I'm doing again November 4th and 5th. This is just a reminder, the encore concert that I did last April. Pretty similar concert, but with all new bad jokes. But the music's pretty much the same. But you are welcome to come back and bring friends, or if you just missed it the first time. But all the proceeds go to Rowan Helping Ministries. I've left a sign-up sheet out in the Fellowship Hall. It's out on the bulletin boards in the Fellowship Hall. And they originally had a sign-up sheet that did not differentiate between the days, and I know Rosa and Louise, and I think it's Glenda, signed up and put they wanted some tickets. But if you don't mind, just next time you're out in the Fellowship Hall, just put down which day you want them, whether it's Thursday or Friday. And I appreciate it. I'm going to leave that sign-up sheet up about 2 more weeks, and then I will bring whatever tickets people indicate they want out here for your convenience. Or you can order them online. But again, I don't make a thing from it. It all goes towards Rowan Helping Ministries. We're shooting to make $12,000 from those two concerts. That's what we're hoping for.
Well, let us begin worship by turning to Thy Word on page 184. We'll do all the verses for the choral intro. Please rise. People gather to break bread and pour wine.
We gather with them in heart and mind.
Around the world, the broken body is made whole.
As part of that body, we join in its unity.
Around the world, the banquet of God is prepared for the table.
We who share in the banquet come eagerly to be fed.
Let us worship together. Let us share God's bounty. And let us turn to our page 460 for Let's Break Bread Together, our opening hymn.
Together on our knees.
Let us pray. Lord, we lift up our hearts to you in thanksgiving and praise, and we ask, Lord, that you would hear our voices of worship, that you would hear our prayers, and that you would inspire us and be with us as you have promised. For where two or more are gathered in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, there is the Lord with him. So we pray these things in your name as we affirm our faith by repeating together the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
I think the choir has fallen in love with this anthem. We originally planned on doing In Remembrance, but I thought we'd do that one for him and use this one for the anthem. I think you'll find it meaningful.
Let us worship the Lord with our gifts. And so I would like to have the deacons to come forward and now read the call to offering. While the people of God wandered in the desert, God provided manna from heaven, water from a rock, and a law to guide their way and to shape their life together. God has fed us too and stayed with us every moment of our own journey so that we are never alone. We are here today to be fed the Lord's Supper with the community of the world and to gather strength in number and in the Spirit of God and our Lord Jesus Christ, so we can reach out in our ministry to the world God loves. Let us gather our gifts together and offer them to God in gratitude, praise, peace, and love. And our offertory is Alleluia on page 189. Let us pray. The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, and Lord, we can only offer to you a small token of our gratitude and of our thanksgiving. So we pray, Lord, that you would take these gifts and bless them and bless the hearts that have given them. And we pray these in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And you may be seated. This morning, Mr. Jesse Holzhauser has our children's message.
Good morning.
Good morning.
So, can you show me an emblem in this church that when you think about it, you think about God?
The cross.
The cross, good. Well, Dr. Rob and me are going to do a series for the whole month of October about the cross. When you look at the cross, is there a letter that you think of when you see the cross?
T.
A T? Where's the T at? Does it look like this T?
No.
But that's a T, right?
Yeah.
Okay. What about on this side if I turn it upside down?
No.
Is that a T? That's not the letter T?
Actually, it is.
Is that a letter T?
Yeah.
Let's try this again, Christian. Does that look like a T? Okay. The T represents trust, the trust that we have in God, right? It's a reminder to us of the trust in God. Trust that God will tell you what's right and what's wrong. Trust that God is always with you. Trust that God will protect you and comfort you in times of trouble. Do you see another letter in this cross? If I turn it this way, do you see a letter in the cross? You need me to help you? That's an L. That's an L. What about that? That's an L. What about that? Well, that's an L. What does the L represent?
Love.
The L is the best reminder of all. The love is visible in so many ways on the cross to remind us of God's love for you. The cross is surrounded by love. Today I'm going to give each of you a cross. Okay? So each Sunday, I want you to wear your cross. These are the crosses. See, I've got one right here. And to let everybody know, when I ordered these crosses for the kids, I got to thinking about the Operation Christmas Child. There's a lot of kids that don't have crosses. So each one of them is going to get one. Okay? So let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for each and every day that you provide for us. Please help people to understand the cross, what it stands for, and that as we're driving down the road, the churches that we pass, people's yards, everywhere we look, and the jewelry we wear, that we all can see what it is that you provided for us through your Son, Jesus. In your name we pray, amen. Yeah, I just wanted every one of the Operation Christmas Childs to have a cross, because a lot of those kids don't get them.
We'll move now into the pastoral prayer, and let me just mention some things while you're thinking about things that we want to include in the prayer. But first of all, it's mentioned in our bulletin, but Mrs. Mary Margaret Klutz passed away, and the members of the church did get an email on her, but she was an associate member, and so we'll remember her in a prayer. The funeral was yesterday at Boker Reformed Church. Billy and Sandy Gilmore. Billy had surgery on Thursday, I think, and he had to have his knee worked on again, and he's still at the hospital, and he does have an infection, unfortunately. He was supposed to go home, so anyway, we'll remember Billy and Sandy, and Eddie and Joni will remember you guys in prayer. And is the surgery still scheduled for this Friday? So Eddie will have complicated surgery, and he'll have it for a few days, and we'll be with you in spirit and in prayer. And then Martha is doing well. Yesterday she told me she's had like 10 treatments, and she's got another 15 or so, 26 to go. So we'll remember Martha and Alton. So those are some of the prayers that we will make. And are there other prayers?
John Wyatt, my brother-in-law.
John Wyatt? And what's going on with John? Yes, Joni.
The family of Claude Marley. Claude passed away this week.
Other requests? Well, let us pray. Praise the Lord, O my soul. All my inmost being, praise his holy name. Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your sins and heals all your diseases, who satisfies you with good things so that your youth is renewed like the eagles. Lord, you do take care of us in so many ways, and we praise you and thank you for the bread of life, Jesus Christ, who came down from heaven and feeds us. We thank you and praise you for the food that you give to us, indeed, after this service. For those who will remain, we will break bread together and have dinner in the fellowship hall. So we thank you for the food you give to us, and we pray for your blessing on that food in particular. Lord, we thank you for the success of yesterday's rummage sale. We thank you for all the souls who worked so hard in making things of bread, the noodles for the bazaar. We thank you for all those activities that have been going on. And we pray, Lord, that you would be with us this week ahead as we prepare for the bazaar. We pray for all of our activities as a church, that you would bless us in those spiritual ways and those physical ways, that we would be, and we know we will, successful through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord, we come before you with some other requests, and we pray for those who have departed from this life. We pray for the spirit, the soul of Claude Lyerly, and for the soul of Mary Margaret Klutz, and we commend them both to you, Lord, and we praise you for the salvation that you give to us in the Lord Jesus Christ, and for the promise of the resurrection of the dead. So we ask you, Lord, to remember your covenant and your sacrifice in Christ Jesus, and extend that to these dear souls. We pray for their families, and that you would comfort and console them. And we remember others who have passed away who we have not mentioned, that these same requests would apply to those. Lord, we pray for those who are sick and suffering. And we remember John Wyatt. We remember Martha and Alton Holzhauser. We remember Billy and Sandy Gilmore. We remember Eddie and Joni Warren. We pray for others that we haven't mentioned, and there are others in our congregation and in our neighborhood that need your healing hand. So, Lord, please be quick to help us. We pray for those who are discouraged or have other burdens upon them. And let us pause just for a moment that we may have a silent prayer with you. Lord, as we prepare our hearts to receive your body and blood, we ask you to forgive us of our sins. Forgive us of our misdeeds, our thoughts, and the things that we haven't done that we should have done. Guide us by your Holy Spirit, Lord, and indeed all of the people around the world who make up your church. Guide us that we may follow the cross of Christ, and that we may become more and more like Jesus Christ as we walk in the way of the cross. Lord, we pray for our community and indeed our nation and world where the darkness of violence seems to be overwhelming. And we pray, Lord, that you would be with our leaders, and that they would seek your light, and that they would rule in just and righteous ways. We pray for those who serve our communities around our country and world, who serve in things where their lives might be endangered. And we remember police people, we remember fire and other emergency help. We remember those who serve our country in the armed forces, Lord, and they are in harm's way. And we pray especially that you would protect them and bring them home to us. We pray, Lord, for your blessing on our great country and our leaders, the United States of America. Finally, Lord, we pray the prayer that you taught us, the one that begins, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen." Our hymn of worship is in remembrance on page 461. So let us rise to sing this hymn. Please be seated. And we're changing the order of worship from the bulletin, so we will have communion now. So I would like to have those who will prepare come up here and get the communion ready. So may the Lord be with you and with your spirit. And we give thanks to the Lord. We lift up our hearts to him. We praise you, Father, because you have been gracious to us. You have created all that is good, and you did not abandon us to our sins. For you sent your only begotten Son, for those who believe in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And you also sent your Holy Spirit to us who believe, that we may be the very children of God. And by this very same Spirit who touched Mary and brought us the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we ask that you would consecrate these, this bread and this wine, that they would be the very body and blood of your Lord Jesus Christ as we do this memorial of our Lord and Savior's death, burial, and resurrection. On the night our Lord was betrayed, he took the loaf and he broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take, eat, for this is my body, broken for you." And after they had eaten, he took the cup and he offered it to them and said, "Take, this is my blood, poured out for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink this, you do this in remembrance of me." And so, Lord, we come to you and we lift up our hearts to you. Forgive us of our sins, and may we receive your body and blood right now. Seal our heart against the suggestions of sinful or evil actions, and instill into us the virtues of the one who broke his body and poured out his blood for us, the Lord Jesus Christ. So I would like to ask the deacons to come forward that we may pass out the elements, the bread first and then the wine.
Thank you.
Lord said, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you." And our Lord said, "Do this in remembrance of me." Our scripture reading today comes from the Gospel of Mark, and this is chapter 6, verses 30 through 44. The apostles gathered around Jesus and reported to him all they had done and taught. Then, because so many people were coming and going that they did not even have a chance to eat, he said to them, come with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest. So they went away by themselves in a boat to a solitary place. But many who saw them leaving recognized them and ran on foot from all the towns and got there ahead of them. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. So he began teaching them many things. By this time, it was late in the day, so his disciples came to him. "This is a remote place," they said, "and it's already very late. Send the people away so they can go to the surrounding countryside and villages and buy themselves something to eat." But he answered, "You give them something to eat." They said to him, "That would take 8 months of a man's wages. Are we to go and spend that much on bread and give it to them to eat?" "How many loaves do you have?" he asked. "Go and see." When they found out, they said, 5 and 2 fish. Then Jesus directed them to have all the people sit down in groups on the green grass. So they sat down in groups of hundreds and fifties, taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to his disciples to set before the people. He also divided the 2 fish among them all. They all ate and were satisfied, and the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces of bread and fish. The number of the men who had eaten was 5,000. Please be seated. And so today let's talk about bread for the weary, taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish and looking up to heaven. He gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to his disciples to set before the people. You know, we read in that passage that the people had traveled to this remote place. They were weary. They were tired. It was the end of the day. It was like yesterday at the end of the rummage sale, or maybe even before that. We were weary. They were weary physically, but they were also weary spiritually. And, you know, even though we've refreshed ourselves from yesterday, we're still weary people too. And we're weary in the same kinds of ways, spiritual and physical ways. But we see Jesus Christ, the Son of God, who is gracious and compassionate to us. He is abounding in love. And he gave bread for the weary, and he gives bread for the weary. So we're going to talk about this passage in sort of a different way today. I'd like to plug this picture in, this scriptural picture, into the big picture that we see in Scripture, because there is one there. But let's first look at this passage and move to the broader picture. By this time, it was late in the day, so his disciples came to him. "This is a remote place," they said, "and it's already very late. Send the people away so they can go to the surrounding countryside and villages and buy themselves something to eat." But Jesus answered, "You give them something to eat." They said to him, "That would take 8 months of a man's wages. Are we to go and spend that much on bread and give it to them to eat?" "How many loaves do you have?" he asked. "Go and see." When they found out, they said, 5 and 2 fish. Then Jesus directed them to have all the people sit down in groups on the green grass. They sat down in groups of hundreds and fifties, taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish and looking up to heaven. He gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to his disciples to set before the people. He also divided the 2 fish among them all. They ate and all were satisfied. So we see Jesus Christ, he gives the bread to these weary people. You know, it said earlier in the passage at the opening that he had compassion on them. And so this isn't just a miracle, a simple miracle. This fits into a bigger picture that we see in the scripture of who we are and of who God is. And before we move into that scriptural survey, we know that bread here in this passage is both physical and spiritual. He's fed the people spiritually first. Remember, he taught them first, and then he gave them that physical bread. And they were weary people physically, but spiritually as well. You know, there's an image with the five loaves and the two fish. You know, what in the world does that symbolize? And people have talked about that for centuries. The five loaves can be a symbol for the five books of the Torah, which is the first part of the Old Testament. In those days as well, and you can look at it today if you ever get a Hebrew Bible, the Hebrew Bible, or the Old Testament then, was divided into three units: the Torah, the law, and then the two fish, the writings and the prophets. So perhaps that's what the symbol is. Physical bread has a symbol for the spiritual bread that we get. So we are weary people, spiritually and physically. But we have many facets. We can be disobedient people. We can be bitter people. We can be starving people. And we can be dying people. And in all of our states, we may vary. We may not be negative all the time. We have moments of being positive. We may vary, but Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He is the one who is compassionate and gracious and loving to us. And he gives us bread, as we see in the picture through the scriptures. You know, the Lord begins the narrative of his presence in our created world with his providing bread for the disobedient. You know, our earthly parents, Adam and Eve, had the free will, as Robert's Sunday school talked about today, free will. They had the free will to disobey the commandment of the Lord, which was to not eat of that tree of the good and of the evil, or of the knowledge of good and evil. So they broke it. They wanted to be like God, as Satan had suggested to them. I'm in control here. I can do what I want. And they did. And they were disobedient. And what did God do? Remember, if you read the Genesis account, if you eat of this tree, you will die. They didn't die. And why didn't they die? Because the Lord is gracious, compassionate, abounding in love. He didn't even curse them. But he cursed other things because of their disobedience. To Adam, God said, because you listened to your wife and ate from the tree about which I commanded you, you must not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil, you will eat of it all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field, namely bread. By the sweat of your brow, you will eat your food until you return to the ground, since from it you were taken, for dust you are, and to dust you will return. So we see in the very opening of the Bible that God is compassionate and forgiving and gracious and provides a way out. We can look at that scripture more detailed and see some things that point to Jesus Christ. But the point is that the Lord was compassionate and merciful to our parents, and he gave them bread, or a way for them to get bread. They would have to work, just like we have to work. But it's God's graciousness that we get this bread. So the Lord gives bread, physical and spiritual, to those who are disobedient. And the Lord even gives bread to the bitter people. We can be weary, and we can be sinful, and we can be bitter and complaining people. We want things our way when we want it, and when we don't get it, we complain. And we can even get angry at God. So how does God treat us? Does he treat our ungratefulness and bitterness with the same? He doesn't. He is gracious and compassionate to us. And we see it in another picture, a different moment in Scripture, and that is with the Israelite community, which set out from Elam and came to the desert of Sin, which is between Elam and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month after they had come out of Egypt. In the desert, the whole community grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. There we sat around pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted, but you have brought us out into this desert to starve this entire assembly to death." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I will rain down bread from heaven to you." The Lord is compassionate and gracious, but we too can be bitter and complaining people. We can be disobedient, and we can be starving as well, especially for spiritual food. I think in the United States, in the most modern countries of the world, there is a famine for the Word of God. But the Lord provides bread even for the starving. And there's another picture we have in Scripture that actually kind of points to the feeding of the 5,000 by Jesus. It's a story when there was a famine in Israel, and it was with the great prophet Elisha. People were starving, and we read the account that you'll see a parallel between this and the Mark passage. A man came from Baal Shalisha, bringing the man of God, Elisha, 20 loaves of barley bread baked from the first ripe grain, along with some heads of new grain. "Give it to the people to eat," Elisha said. "How can I set this before 100 men?" his servant asked. But Elisha answered, "Give it to the people to eat, for this is what the Lord says. They will eat and have some left over." Then he set it before them, and they ate and had some left over according to the word of the Lord. So the miracle of Jesus giving that bread and the fish in that remote location fits into the pattern of these things that I've told you, these stories I've told you. We are weary people. We're disobedient, sinful. We're bitter people and starving people. And we may not be the greatest people all of the time. And I may not be the greatest guy all the time. But the point is that the Lord is. The Lord is compassionate and gracious and loving to us and gives us the bread that we need and that bread that comes down from heaven that we have received already. In fact, we receive that bread and we receive the bread of the living word, the scriptures. Now, I think that when he did that miracle with the 5,000, he was looking towards that final meal, which was the Lord's Supper, which is the gift of the body of Christ for all of us. While the Lord provides bread for all of us and all of our different things, he gives us the ultimate food, which is that bread that comes down from heaven. And we celebrated this just a few moments ago, and this is the scripture that talks about it, the same gospel we've been reading from, the Gospel of Mark. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and offered it to them, and they all drank from it. "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many," he said to them. "I tell you the truth, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it anew in the kingdom of God." So the Lord's table is what we call communion, and it's also called the Eucharist. The Eucharist is a powerful word for this sacrament. Eucharist literally means to give thanks. Jesus gives thanks for the bread he offered to the thousands. Jesus gave thanks to the bread that he offered to us in the Lord's table. The Eucharist, or the bread of Christ, completes our picture, because we can be all these negative people, and Jesus, who experienced all the negativity of life, and more so than what we ever can have or will, he was able to give thanks. For us who are sinful, disobedient, or bitter, or whatever else, we're called to be thankful people. And so Christ gives thanks for bread, and so should we. We should give thanks for the earthly bread we receive, and we should give thanks for the spiritual bread that we receive. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to his disciples to set before the people. So let us close with a prayer, because we have received communion today, the Lord's bread. From the depths of our hearts, we thank you, dear Lord, for your infinite kindness in coming to us. How good you are to us. We praise your mercy and generosity toward us as sinners. We thank you for nourishing us with your sacred body and with your precious blood. We will try to show our gratitude to you by obedience to your commandments, by fidelity to our duties, by kindness to our neighbors, and by an earnest endeavor to become more like you in our daily conduct. Amen. Well, friends, we're going to close with the hymn, Break Thou the Bread of Life. It's on page 413. Let's rise to sing our let's rise to sing our closing hymn.
First two verses.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift up his eyes upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord smile upon you and grant you peace. Amen.